Hi, we're in beautiful Southern California in Anaheim at the NAMM Show, the biggest collection of new equipment for DJs, musicians, and everybody else. Let's go inside, see what's going on, and have some fun. Hi, we're here with Dave Smith from Dave Smith's Instruments with his new baby, the Tempest drum machine that we've been, well, I think the whole industry has been waiting for. And, you know, Dave, tell us about your new baby.
This was a collaboration with myself and Roger Lynn. I was, very roughly speaking, more responsible for the sound generation side of it, the analog synthesizer engine. And Roger was more responsible for the UI. Obviously, he's a drum machine king forever. Yeah. So he came up with some clever new ideas, and the marriage of the, it's kind of like nonstop manipulation of both the beat and the sound, and there's nothing else anywhere like that out there. Nobody's really done this type of analog drum machine before, and with the nonstop manipulation of the beat, we just started going, you could flop into MPC mode, you could do it 303, you know, 808 mode and do step sequencing, mute things, turn things on and off, hop back and forth, all without stopping.
So it sounds like it's not only a great machine for the studio, but also for live performance.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, it's what's fun is you just start it going and start playing with things and see where it takes you. Because you can just hop between everything and change beats, you know, synchronously, of course, and all the simple stuff. But then when you start tweaking the analog sound while it's playing and trashing things, taking it in and out.
Yeah, freaking it out, trashing things are the I think the secrets of, like, making thousands of people on the dance floor go crazy, you know?
And that's what I like to do. I mean, I just love twisting the sound up and turning it inside out and so forth. So.
Yeah, I think this is what I love about the machine. You've got your pads, you've got quick access, but you have all these knobs and you can quickly really manipulate the sound. And I think that's what everybody, you know, that's, I guess, what we're all looking for, a way to really get in there and, you know, change our actions into something wonderful that you hear.
Exactly, because, you know, drum machines so far have all been sample based. And everybody, you know, they have billions of samples and megabits and megabytes of this and that, but it's still a sample. When all said and done, it's a sample. This is an analog synthesizer. We do have some samples in there, but the combination of the two, you could do so much more fluid and interactive than playing samples. So instead of being stuck with a drum machine where, okay, how many samples do I have to stack to make this sound interesting, you don't need to do that. You play one voice, it's analog, it's got that raw power, it's just, it's fun, it's cool.
Well, I just got mine at my house in Berlin. I can't wait to get back, get into the studio with it, and also hopefully take it out on the stage later this year. So,
cool.
Congratulations. It's also 10 years of Dave Smith Instruments.
It is.
We're gonna have a toast afterwards to congratulate you with your yearly tequila surprise. Hi, we're standing here with Roger Lynn, one of the chief designers with Dave Smith on the Tempest drum machine that we were just talking about. But I'd like to talk a little bit more about the future. You know, on your website, you've had this incredible YouTube video of you talking about a new instrument, a touch instrument called the Linstrument. You know, tell us a little bit about it and maybe your vision of the future of interfacing and music production.
Well, I'm creating an instrument, still creating an instrument, because I saw a problem, and that's that I love synthesis, and synthesis has incredible potential, particularly some of the new forms of software synthesis. They have great potential to produce the sort of subtle nuances of a violin or a guitar or clarinet or cello, but when you try to play them with a keyboard, they just sound horrible. They always sound flat, and they sound like a buzzsaw or something. And there's really no way to control synthesis to produce that sort of nuanced, beautiful solos that we've heard from these classic instruments in the mechanical age. So I wanted to create something that allowed that, and the way I do it is, an instrument is actually a multi-touch pressure-sensitive surface that scans your finger pressure and movements in three dimensions. So with one finger, you can wiggle it left and right for pitch, you can wiggle it, you can change the pressure for expression, note volume and filter, for example, or you can move your finger forward and backward for note timbre. And by doing this, with these three parameters adjusted at one time by each finger, you get this beautiful note expression, and you can do it polyphonically. And so it's really something that is needed, because if you're a synthesis right now, you got two choices. Or if you're a musician, you can either work with synthesis and have bad controllers, or you can play mechanical age instruments. Yeah. But there's really nothing that bridges the gap.
Yeah, I know this was, as you're talking, the word expression comes to mind, and I think we're in a very interesting position in electronic music right now. It's becoming more popular. The synthesis is incredibly powerful, but it feels like we can't get the full expression that we have as human beings through this technology and actually hear it at the end. You know, and I'm hoping that this is the development we're looking for.
Yeah, me too.
You know, I'm hearing a lot of young kids working on electronic music, using a mouse, using even an iPad or a keyboard. Yeah. And I think we're at a bottleneck. And it's not the ideas that we have. I think there's plenty of great ideas. It is this interface bottleneck.
Yeah. I think so. I agree.
Well, you know, you've always been an innovator and someone key to the whole industry of electronic music and music in general. So we're looking forward to the instrument and anything else that's in your crazy mind. A big surprise for me, walking around NAMM, we just ran into Anthony from PSP Audioware. And hello. Anybody, what? Hello, hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello.
So anybody who knows any of my DJ sets from the last 10 years may know the special effect that I use with my special PSP 42 delay, which is right over here. Incredible effects, PSPAudioware.com. You know, you can check out the delay that I use or all the other effects. An incredible site for your production or for your live shows. So just, great to finally meet the guys from PSP.
Hello.
Hello.
It's great to see you.
We're seeing kind of a theme at NAMM this year. We've only been here 13 minutes or 15 minutes, and it's our second alcoholic beverage that we've got. So we're here with Matthew from Aurea, a new company, I think, but I read about this last week, a full professional editing audio DAW on an iPad, and here we are to actually see it in the flesh.
Yep. Up to 48 tracks, it's recording, editing, mixing, all in one package.
So do you see this as the future of live recording or actual production in the studio?
There's some wonderful applications for live recording or just working on the road. Taking an existing project, maybe that someone started in Logic, transferring it onto here before they went on vacation and want to overdub some acoustic guitar on the beach.
Or on the plane. You know, I'm always working on the plane.
And you could edit. I mean, if you wanted to, you could edit, you could mix, you could work on automation, things like that, and then export it and bring it into your favorite DAW that way.
So there you go, 48 channels of recording and playback and editing with a full channel strip on every one of those on an iPad. I didn't believe it. I still, I'm in awe of it, but the future is definitely here.
Yep.
Cool. Congratulations. So you have one extreme using iPads, like the new Moog iPad to make music. And then you have this extreme where you have untold amounts of modulation possibilities. Incredible, it looks cool. You can make incredible sounds, but you can get stuck just playing around for hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and never actually make a song. So everyone's got a different balance. Everyone has got a different wish of the sound that they want, but this type of modular systems do offer an incredible new world to get into. A new analog synthesizer called the Coma here from Eowave. So the show is full of new and interesting analog synthesizers. It's incredible. So maybe tell us a little bit about this.
Sure. Yeah, this is a one oscillator with a sub oscillator synthesizer and a noise generator. So this is the mixer section. So you can have the sawtooth and the square wave at the same time, just mix them in. The sub oscillator, which is a square wave, you can detune. And you can actually do that manually, or you can have the LFO modulating it, or the envelope. So that's what the M, L, and E are.
So with the sub-oscillator, is this more of a bass synthesizer, or?
It's targeted more like a 303 or something like that.
Or like a 101 or 202. This is what first came to mind, because these devices were just great for that kind of sound. So many knobs and buttons, but that's the beauty of a small little analog device like this that makes it fun again, Sitting with my mouse and my computer keyboard just isn't as fun as it used to be. So congratulations, looks really cool. So
yep.
As you can see at NAMM, we're at the Behringer booth, there's an incredible diversity of different controllers and new products for the DJ market from every level, entry, professional. But what's interesting is that everybody's got a slightly different take. You know, I don't agree with everything I'm seeing here or everything that I'm hearing, but you know, who am I? I'm just one person. There's enough for everybody to find their way into DJing and electronic music production, and that's an incredible thing. We're here with Chris from DJ Tech Tools, one of the, I guess, premier websites to help aspiring DJs and professional DJs. You know, I'm using them. You know, what are they doing? Making cool-ass little controllers, which are, you know, you can buy ready-made. You can kind of build them yourself. You can modify them. If you don't like the buttons and things on your mixer, you can find cool new ones which feel much better. So it's like a one-shop stop for customization for the DJ, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
You know, and like for any like old schoolers like me who used to play a lot of Centipede or Pac-Man, or these are actually arcade grade buttons. So brings you back to those old times, and they're incredibly responsive if you're triggering clips or doing samples. So it, you know, it's anything. Any new controller gives you a new interface, a new potential into the software that's already there. And that's exactly what the MIDI Fighter did for me, you know.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, you know, it has extra analog and digital input, so you can really do your own thing. So, you know, we're really trying to allow people to customize and make their ideas come true, so you can kind of do whatever you want, and whether it's on the software or the hardware side or whatever.
It's a great DJ Tech Tools, customization to make your ideas come true. Yeah. Perfect. Cool. Thank you. So, what good is great equipment without beautiful and incredibly strong cables to hook it all up? We're here with my friend Kenji from Japan.
Yeah.
It's also a good friend of my friend Dubfire, and they're specializing in DJ grade cables that you can travel with and make sure all that shit works when you need it to. So there you go. You have USB cables, you have audio cables, all high grade, so that the audio signals sound great, so that your USB connection is fast and stable, so that when you're in front of 500, 50, 5 people, 50,000, your shit works and you're rocking. Kenji, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Synthesizers and drum machines. We just saw the Dave Smith drum machine, the Tempest, which is, in my mind, incredible. And we just saw the Nord drum machine, which honestly, I'm a little bit disappointed. Only one output, it's more digital. So, you know, if you need that one machine that's gonna give you a lot of different sounds and a lot of possibilities, maybe it's not the one. But in design and the heritage and what they've done in the past, I wouldn't not look into the Nord. It's worth checking out, but, you know, maybe a little bit limited. So we're here with Charles from Arturia, and another cool little but probably powerful mini analog synth. So, you know, I find it a little bit strange. You guys are known for your soft synths, you know, all in the computer, all in the box, and now here you are with a little analog baby. So that's a wave shaper, a wave folder, or a...
Yeah, it's kind of a wave folder. It's called Metalizer.
Okay.
That has a sync type sound to it. It's actually going to be even affected by the envelope.
Okay.
Then you have a noise input and you have an audio input, so you can introduce external audio at this point.
So external, what we got in the back here?
Oh yeah.
Oh, we got gates and everything. CV?
Full CV gate in and out, USB 2.0. It'll actually send key control messages from the keyboard.
Remember all those little modular things we saw somewhere else earlier? All that has CV input, so this not only is a beautiful little self-contained unit, but you can interface it with other things that are out there and beyond MIDI. So it's the best of the old and best of the new.
Absolutely.
Well, out of everything I've seen, it's the first thing today that I want to take home. You know, it's beautiful and it sounds incredible. Definitely, I can't wait to have one in my studio. So. And I just arrived from Berlin 2 days ago, and before I got to NAMM, I was in my studio moving some equipment around, and I found one of my most favorite little synthesizers, the SEM from Tom Oberheim. A beautiful monophonic, you know, beauty. And here we are in NAMM with a soft synth version from the same company, Arturia, whose other little bugger that we just saw. So.
Hi, Richie.
Hi.
Thank you for the introduction. So, yes, this is the emulation actually I made of the famous Oberheim SEM synthesizer expander module from 1974. We've emulated the SEM thanks to our TAE processing. So you can recognize the SEM module in the middle with the exact replica of the VCF, which goes from bandpass to low pass, merge and high pass position continuously, which gives this typical character of the SEM.
This is one of the beauties of the SEM, that you could, you know, seamlessly kind of like move from the low pass to the high pass filter. It was it wasn't available on every synthesizer at that moment. So, you know, what I'd like to talk about is, like, you guys, you know, have had great success doing, you know, virtual versions of very classic devices. You have the Yamaha, you have Moog.
Yes, yes,
you know, you have Dave Smith, Sequential Circuits, my favorite.
Yeah.
Why did it take so long for someone to bring Tom Oberheim's SEM to the virtual world? I was waiting for this for years.
Yeah, it's true. We had a lot of demand on this particular synth, and you know, there are also behind the scenes agreements, and when we did it, we wanted to do it with the Oberheim brand as well.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Arturia, and I guess we should say thank you for Tom Oberheim for allowing this to happen, because, you know, I know Tom is also making SEMs again. Hopefully he's here somewhere, but not everybody can afford a hardware, and I think it's great that you have both options of virtual and hardware in 2012. So
thank
congratulations.
Thank you.
So we just saw the NPC 2000 iPad edition, and I don't know, I'm a little bit disappointed because, you know, Akai, for me, when I was growing up, had incredible samples. They were on the cutting edge, and now they're just kind of rehashing what they've been doing for, as it says over there, 25 years on an iPad. I was expecting a little bit more. Hi, I'm here with Matt from Keith McMillan Designs, and we're with a really interesting machine because it's actually something that I've already paid for on Kickstarter to help them develop it, but I've never even seen it. So here we go. Let's look at this Cuneo, which is a really, what I'm hoping to be, an incredible new touch interface.
Yes. So this is Cuneo. Take a look. It's
And it's really light and really cool already.
We're super excited about it. It's what we're calling a 3D multi-touch pad controller, and the reason why we're calling it 3D multi-touch is because each pad does not only triggers, but also pressure and XY. So if I engage our pressure XY demo, I've got an auto filter down here in live with the pressure controlling cutoff, and the X controlling Q, and the Y controlling the amount of that filter. Each pad can do those all independently of notes and velocity. So it can send notes, velocity, pressure, X, and Y CCs at the same time.
This is exactly what we were talking to Roger Lin earlier about. Electronic music, or maybe just music in general, needs a better interface because synthesis has so much power. Ableton, you know, you can't even access it with your fingertips, but this, maybe you can.
You know, each pad can send multiple types of information at the same time, allowing for error and intricate performative technique. Also, everything else on the board sends pressure. Whoa. Every single slider, every single button, everything. If I open our sensor view, you can see when I push harder on one of these vertical sliders, you can see the pressure of my finger. That sends its own XCC as well as the position of my finger. The rotaries do that as well. They send a radius, they send pressure, they send position. Everything is pressure sensitive.
I think this is exactly what, you know, is one of the next big developments in music, you know.
Yes. It's
interfacing and like having more control. The other thing I'd like to talk about is coming up with new ideas and new technology is one thing, but actually bringing it to market is another thing, because it's cost a lot of money to develop these great ideas. You guys did something really innovative by going to Kickstarter to actually ask your customers to help support and bring this to fruition.
Well, that was the idea, because, you know, we're a really small company. We got 10 people in-office maximum. We've got some reps around the country who work for us part-time doing things, but we're not rolling in money. You know, we make soft step and 12 step, some other really crazy products, Kabo, Gestural, Violin Bows, things like that. We asked Kickstarter customers, people, supporters to back us. Within 12 hours, we were fully funded.
I think this is a great way to see, you know, walking around here, we see the Dave Smiths, we see Don Buchla, we see Roger Lynn, all these people have been in the industry for years, and they're still able to be part of an independent progression of technology and music making.
Yeah.
And I think this was, you know, really interesting to see that a positive impact of internet technologies to allow you guys to also innovate. There's two things to check out. You know, you want to check out Keith McMillan, you know, all the instruments and crazy things that they're doing online. And you also want to check out Kickstarter, because there's other like cool projects that need your support and allow cool ideas and independent people to do the things that they dream of. And that's a wonderful thing. So we're here with Steve at Move Music. We've been waiting for this moment for the last like 4 hours, walking around and seeing cool new things. But here we are finally with the Minotaur.
Yeah. So Minotaur is our newest analog-based synth. It's a two oscillator analog synth. Two oscillators are sent to the Moog filter. And it's designed for bass. It delivers that.
Well, you can't feel it on the TV here, but it's perfect.
So the sound it comes from the legendary Taurus One synthesizer. We've done a few nice little changes to it. We've added square waves. You can mix the two oscillators together. You can have them in different waveforms. You can set the tuning between the two oscillators.
Now this is exactly what we want to see. We want to see a progression in analog synths and design with modern thinking and modern circuitry, you know, something that we wouldn't have seen 10 or 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Well, it's like, I think we've seen a lot of things at this show, but we've seen three or four incredible small little monosynths. And, you know, if you're gonna have a small monosynth, you might as well have one with Moog stamped on it. You know, it's incredible. And I think a great testament to how vibrant electronic music is today.
Yeah.
So congratulations on that.
Thank you
for the demo. So here we are at the Livid booth, and with a very personal favorite controller of mine, the Livid Minus Collaboration controller. So here we have what we feel is the best balance of controls at your fingertips. This was developed with the Minus gang, with Geyser, Mark Poole, you know, Troy Pierce, Magda, and myself, thinking about what was missing and trying to cram as much into a small, you know, package as possible so that we can just carry it everywhere and destroy at all the Minus nights that we do. So it's set up in a number of different ways. You can use it for Traktor, and you can use it for Ableton or any other you know, device that you want, fully mappable with MIDI. But for me, putting this with Ableton is where the magic comes out. This turns into a full step sequencer. You have control over note velocity, filters over the ADSR. You can turn things on and off. You have note repeat. You have all the things that you may find on other devices, but I think more intuitive and more control at the fingertips. That's why it's called the Control R, and available through LividInstruments.com, also through Minus.com. And if you can't see it in person, then find out where the nearest Minus artist is playing, because they'll probably have it on stage with them too. So Livid Minus Control R. So, I was here at NAMM last year, and I was doing a blog, and part of my blog was about this video modular synthesizer. I didn't get close to it last year, but it was so fucking cool that I've been dreaming about it for 1 year. So here we are with Lars, the inventor, you know, and he's gonna show us a little bit more of what this thing can do.
This is a video oscillator, the same as a normal voltage-controlled oscillator, except it goes much faster, and it goes up to 4 megahertz in frequency. Everything in the system runs as a 1 volt DC coupled voltage, whether it's video, audio, LFO, CV, logic. Everything shares the same signal path. So there's this camera right here, and now it's going in. we can control the inversion of that camera or so on. What happens when we speed the oscillator up into the audio range above 30 hertz, it starts becoming part of the image. The speed of the scrolling and the number of lines you see depend on the frequency of the oscillator and how close it is to a multiple of that 60 hertz field rate. So if we take the field rate clock out of the sync generator and synchronize the oscillator, it's telling the oscillator to reset every time the TV jumps up to the top. So you're seeing multiple repetitions of the oscillator. And the oscillator sync is the same as like on a normal analog VCO. In the audio range, the speed that the display prints lines down the side is 15 kilohertz. So if we go faster than that, we're going to synchronize the oscillator to the line rate. And then we can create vertical bars. So these are running much faster than the audio range. The horizontal bars kind of coincide with the range of human hearing.
You know, we're gonna go over probably some of the heads of the people who are gonna watch this, but everybody's so caught up in audio and digital and that analog digital debate or whatever, but to see something fresh like this in the visual realm is incredible, because we're doing a lot of visuals with my Plastic Man Live show, and a lot of that is generative, but it's heavy computing power, and it's got a beautiful look, but this gives a different texture, a different feeling, I guess you're going to keep building modules. This is an ongoing project?
Yes, it's grown. There's probably 50 system owners over the past year, which is really great. Once you understand the whole sync generator encoder part of it, then the rest of it is mostly just standard analog synth modules, but at a much higher bandwidth so that they can pass the higher frequencies.
Yeah. Okay.
So you got mixers, voltage controlled crossfader.
And you said everything is running at one volt?
1 volt. Yeah, and that's because of the frequency.
So can you then convert from a general audio surge module or anything and do cross patching and control things?
Yeah,
okay.
So this module is called the voltage bridge. It does like a voltage division of 5 and a voltage gain of 5, just as like a standard interface.
Yeah.
You could also patch like your usual 10 volt control voltage directly in. You just have a little bit less range on the knob.
I think it's beyond my understanding right now, but I thought I wanted one last year, now I know I want one this year. And as it says on the sign, the future of video is back. Wow, what a day at NAMM. Incredible things all over the place. My brain is buzzing. New toys, new synthesizers, new drum machines, and we're back where we started at the Dave Smith Instruments booth, and actually kind of back where I started, because when I did my first record, I had this cool synthesizer that we did Cybersonic on, +8 No. 3, Technarchy, back in the day, was with Dave's first company, Sequential Circuits and the Pro One. What an incredible machine. So here we go. Thank you very much for joining us. I hope you all have a wonderful time in the world of electronic music. Ciao.